businesses now go up.
Call the meeting to order. Just as a reminder, if anybody wants to speak, please fill out a comment card and give it to Stephen, our city clerk. Roll call.
Councilmember Plaza.
Here.
Councilmember Rigby.
Here.
Councilmember Rush.
Here.
Mayor Protem Larmour.
Here.
Mayor Casella.
Here. Tonight's invocation will be presented by Pastor Sam Tanner of Life Church, to be followed by the pledge by Councilmember Rigby.
Heavenly Father, I just want to pray for our nation. Our country seems to not be working together so well. And I ask, Father, that you would just put it on our hearts to be more unified as a nation, as an American people. And Father, I thank you for this city and this council, our community, and the unity that you've allowed us to experience here. May we not lose that. May we always put the needs of our city first and foremost, and may we always seek your guidance and counsel on how to do that wisely. So, Lord, we ask for your blessing over tonight. We ask that you help each of these leaders to make wise and informed decisions that will first help the city and also glorify you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Pastor Tanner.
Will the audience please rise? Place your right hand over your heart and please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. Ready? Begin.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, with that, we're going to move on to item 3, which is closed session.
Mr. Mayor, just for the record, the closed session is pursuant to Government Code 54956.9, initiation of litigation, and number of potential cases is 1.
All right, we're going to recess to closed session. All right. Court's now in session. All right, we're going to reconvene. Okay, we're going to reconvene the council meeting. City Attorney.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. The City Council did hold a duly authorized closed session under the Government Code, Section 54956.9, initiation of litigation, number of potential cases 1. At this point, there is publication at this point to the public as far as the items discussed in closed session. So it's not reportable at this time, sir.
Okay. And just for the public's information, the city manager was going to give an update on the birthing home situation, but due to an ongoing investigation, we've instructed her not to provide any further information regarding that.
Yes,
so there will
Mr.
not
Mayor,
be an update.
At this particular time, any updates are not recommended, and I advised against those based on the fact that there are ongoing investigations right now, and that would jeopardize the investigations by the cities. Thank you.
We're going to move on to item 4, presentations and announcements, and at this time I'd like to invite Lieutenant Forbes up to introduce East Vail's special enforcement team.
As you know, we have a
contract with the Sheriff's Department and the City of Eastvale to include patrol staffing hours. We do our best to keep our patrol deputies the same deputies day in and day out where there is movement. However, you have a number of dedicated deputy sheriffs assigned to the city. And those include your traffic team and your SET team. And it's my pleasure to introduce you to some new faces on the special enforcement team as we just went through a major restructuring and shift change stationwide. We have some new faces. So without further ado, first I would like to introduce you to Sergeant Brooks. He has been with the Sheriff's Department since 1994, and I have a very long autobiography, but I'm going to skip through the bulk of it. He was transferred to the Group of Allen Station last April, and it's after 22 years of experience with our department. He's heading up the Special Enforcement Team for Eastvale and also our some of our contracts. Next, Deputy Hansen. He's been with the Sheriff's Department for just over 10 years and has had a number of assignments at the Roof Valley Station, as well as other areas in the department. Something unique about Deputy Hansen, although he is new to the city as a special enforcement team member, he was one of the first deputies who volunteered to come over to work the Eastvale contract exclusively when we first incorporated. So although he's new to the SET team here in Eastvale, he has been with the city since 2010. And last but not least, we have Deputy Harrington. He has been with the Sheriff's Department for a little over 8 years, and he has been assigned to the Arupa Valley Station since 2013. And he's worked various assignments both in the city of Eastvale as well as some of the surrounding areas. And that is our special enforcement team.
Thank you very much. Welcome aboard and happy hunting.
Mr. Mayor?
Yes, sir.
If I may. Gentlemen, thank you for your service and be safe out there, especially in a time where men and women in your profession are unfortunately not regarded as highly as they should be. I know your predecessors did a yeoman's work, and we have no doubt you guys will do the same. So thank you and stay safe.
Thank you, guys.
We'll move on to item 5, our student liaison report.
Thank you. Ronald Reagan Elementary School is currently doing great. They're very excited to be hosting their father-daughter dance, which will be held this Friday, February 10th. And this event will be taking place on campus and should be a fun-filled evening. And furthermore, Ronald Reagan will be having a school site council meeting next month, Monday, March 27th, from 2:30 to 3:30 p.m. And also, the elementary school will be having an exciting spirit night coming up on May 10th. And they're asking the whole community to come out and support at the McDonald's on Lima Night for this event, which staff and admin will be working for the night. And Eastvale Elementary had a successful book fair for the last 2 weeks. And every week they're holding gate academics. And the last one was based on tessellations. And currently they're starting up a valet service in which sixth graders will be helping with the parent drop-off in the morning. And they're also planning an assembly to celebrate Black History Month. Also, Harada Elementary will be hosting a father-daughter dance this Friday as well, February 10th. And they'll also be having a mother-son Ontario Reign hockey game that will be held on March 27th. And they will be also hosting a color run on Saturday, April 8th. And finally, Eleanor Roosevelt will be having a Yogurtland fundraiser tomorrow from 3 to 9 p.m. And it will be supporting ASB. Also, tomorrow night, they will be hosting the senior night for boys soccer and boys basketball. Yeah. That's all. Any questions?
Councilman Rush?
Not necessarily for Ms. Diaz, but there was a young lady, I think last meeting of the meeting before, that came and talked about parking and traffic issues coming out of Rosa Parks. Not now, but I didn't know if there's any update or resolution to that. So maybe at the end or the next meeting. I was just curious how that was progressing. Thank you, Natalie.
I have a quick comment, if I may, Mr. Mayor, on that. Councilman Rush, we do have a, forgive me on the exact name of the meeting tomorrow, Eastville Schools Committee, and that's one of our topics. So hopefully the next city council meeting will be able to update you a little bit more on the traffic issue.
Thank you.
What time do you guys meet?
1:30, I think.
Thank you. Thank you, Natalie.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lieutenant Forbes.
I will move on to public comments, and just to reiterate, any member of the public may address the council on items within the council's subject matter jurisdiction, but which are not listed on this agenda during public comments. However, no action may be taken on matters that are not part of the posted agenda, and we request that comments made on the agenda be made at the time the item is considered, and that comments be limited to 2 minutes per person. Please address the council when you do give your comments, and do not engage in dialogue with our staff members. Do we have any requests?
Yes, we received 3 public comment cards. The first speaker is Ray Hernandez.
Mr. Hernandez.
First, let me say good evening, Mayor, Council Member, staff. My name is Ray Hernandez. I live on Dearborn Street here in Eastville. I come before you again on the subject of mail clock crime in the city. Based on data from Lieutenant Scott Forbes, there has been 28 incidents reported in January 2017 and 4 arrests that were involved in mail thefts at Eastville. 28, almost one day late. If you measure that differently, there's 16 mailboxes in a cluster, that's 400 residents. I wonder how many credit cards have been stolen, how much personal ID has been stolen, Social Security. I'm just amazed. We need to do more. Now, I come up here not to complain, but also maybe solutions, maybe recommendations. I do have one that I'd like to share with you. Establish a public monetary reward or information leading to the arrest and conviction of any mailbox crimes within the city. This announcement can be mailed directly to all residents, informing them of the following system, explaining the amount of mailbox crimes there are in the city, and the reward information. Additionally, the city can provide posters for retail storefronts, including photo images on posters showing what a mailbox breach looks like, reaching out to retail store owners to install posters in front of the stores, implemented or by the help of the Chamber of Commerce. This is a deterrent. I believe this could be a method of scaring, moving the criminals out of the city. I was here last meeting, and I appreciate City Manager Michelle Neeson's comments on the last council meetings in regards to mailbox crime communications to the residents. The web pages are all good. However, we need to do better. I provided you up here some information that is on the website. Some of it is for Lieutenant Scott Forbes, and it's all good, all well. There's nothing wrong with it. We just have to, I believe, make it better. Some way, somehow. I will end tonight with a statement. It's an old business credo stating, if you continue down the same failing path, how would you expect better results in the future?
Thank you, Mr. Hernandez.
Thank you, Mr. Hernandez. Did you get a copy of, we got a handout here. Is this publicly available, Michelle?
It's on the website.
I was not provided a copy of what you're looking at, so that is on the website.
Okay.
Almost
appreciate that. You bring up a good point, which makes me think of a question of not necessarily rewards, but kind of victim reimbursement. I know there's the demand is probably much more than the supply, but I think the district attorney's office has some type of victim rights fund or program. The lieutenants, are you aware of the particulars of that?
I was digesting the information, sir.
Oh, okay. I mean, I don't know if something like that would be available, at least from a procedural standpoint, to the district attorney's office, so maybe we could look in and follow up. That there's, you know, you're a victim of a crime. I think there's a fund set aside. Like I said, the amount in the piggy bank is probably pales in relationship to how much is lost, but maybe something from a procedural standpoint. But we are working on the issue as much as we can and within the confines of the abilities we have, and I think we're putting more pressure on our partners in the feds to try to get them on board too. So,
yeah, I think what Councilman Rush is referring to is a victim restitution fund.
Correct. Thank
but you. I don't know how the district attorney's office would address putting out a reward, but I like the idea.
What about the city? Does the city have an emergency fund for that?
Not for that particular thing, but it's definitely something we'll look into.
Okay.
Yeah, and this, just for your own information, this has been brought up to our state legislators, and unfortunately at the state level, there's absolutely no desire to change anything to put more people in jail. The idea up there is to get the people out of prison. Unfortunately, mail theft is a petty theft. It's and identity theft, you don't see it until long down the road, and that's a misdemeanor. So it's tough. I mean, there's really the repercussions for being caught are little right now, especially with Prop 47 and 57. That creates the revolving door. But we are taking steps. There are things in the pipeline, and hopefully we'll see something soon.
Mr. Mayor, if I may.
Councilman Rigby.
Regarding those 28 incidents that Lieutenant Forbes gave you, Lieutenant Forbes, are you aware if those are individual residents that could be in the same cluster, or are those 28 different boxes that are being...
Actually, I'm glad you asked, because I was going to offer that up. It's difficult to pinpoint exactly where those occurred, because one victim may say the crime occurred at the corner of X and Y. Another victim may say, provide their address as the location of occurrence. But looking at the plotting out the 28 victims who reported mail theft in January, we've narrowed it down to 13 mailbox clusters. So 28 victims of theft from those 13 clusters is the best we can narrow it down.
Thank you.
Yeah, and the possibility with the numbers you gave, that's a legitimate possibility, because people don't know, if they don't know what was in the mailbox, they don't know if they're the victim. So basically the stat would be to whoever actually filed the report for the vandalism and the theft. So it wouldn't include everybody.
Thank you. Thank you for
your
response.
Thank you, Mr. Hernandez.
We need to communicate better to our residents. Hopefully everybody gets more involved in today. I'm not convinced situation.
You're right. Thank you.
Thank you. Our second speaker is Tom D'Antoni.
Mr. D'Antoni.
Hello. I'm here on behalf of the Cub Scout Pack to go through Hughesville. We are the distinguished largest Cub Scout Pack in the Inland Empire, so we're proud to be part of the city of Hughesville. We have been since the inception of our PAC focused on the environment. We love Eastville, and now we have stopped basically doing community service projects outside of our city, and have really been refocusing our efforts to events like concerts in the park, cleaning stuff off signs, and picking up trash, which are great things that our little kids like to do. We have kids as young as 6 years old, which are tigers, and as old as 10-year-olds, which are weeblos that are getting ready to become Boy Scouts. As you're aware, Eastville has a really great program for adopting a road. We thought that was an excellent idea, and we had actually submitted an application to take three sections of Scholar, which is not Scotland, I'm sorry, Citrus, which is the entirety of Citrus, because we have a lot of people. And Ms. Nissen was helping us with that and doing a lot of good work, and then we kind of ran across a snag. It turns out there's a technicality in the rules that were established here for a good reason that limits the age, the minimum age, to 10 years old. Well, that gives me about 12 kids out of my under five. So what we'd like to propose is the consideration of some changes to that ordinance with the consideration of safety in mind, and also, you know, in a way that we maybe can minimize potential liability of the city. Suffice to say, we don't want a bunch of little kids running around. So you understand, in Scouts, that's just not how we roll. We have extensive leadership at our younger levels. We have one-on-one adult supervision across the board. I have 105 kids. I also have 38 trained adult leaders, which is also the most in the Inland Empire. I have first responders, first aid technicians. You name it, we've got it. Okay. So what I would propose is the consideration that perhaps you allow the younger kids to participate, with the idea in mind that we have a ratio of one or three children for every one adult, and that way we can continue to serve the community.
I like the idea. Yeah. Thank you. Anybody?
Yes, go ahead.
No. Councilman Plott.
What would be, you know, some of the liabilities in having, you know, I think it's a great idea, and I think we probably something we should look into considering as far as supervision and the ratio of that supervision. Have we gone down that road already with the city staff as far as looking to come up with some type of solution to create maybe a 3-to-1 ratio? Telling Mr. what Mr. Donatoni was saying. And if so, what are the concerns with that, and how can we kind of implement that to make that happen?
Well, when thank you, Councilmember Plott. That's a very good question. When we established this program by request of the City Council, we did look at several other programs that are up in operation in various cities. So we kind of took from their lessons learned and proposed, if I recall, the first draft that came to you guys was actually, I think, was a threshold of 12 years old, and it was then dropped to 10. The thought process behind 10 at staff level was mostly about maturity of the kids, because they are going to be close to the public right of way, they are going to be on the shoulder of the road, and JCSD had expressed to make sure that they're not tromping through the landscape, that they're picking up trash, to be aware of breaking sprinkler heads and things of that nature. So it was truly a suggestion based on maturity. Typically, kids that are 10 years old tend to be a little bit more mature and follow more directions. The ratio of children to parents, that there are some guidelines in the rules that were adopted. They do need to be accompanied by an adult. I don't have the information right in front of me, but I believe if they're a minor, they have to be accompanied by an adult one-to-one. That was the rules that were established because of the liability issues in the public right-of-way. Although the parents do have to sign a hold harmless agreement.
They do or don't?
Do.
I'm sorry?
They do or don't?
They do. They do. Everyone has to sign a hold harmless.
A waiver
for liability.
Now, this is for children that are at the age of 10.
This is for all volunteers that are participating, mm-hmm. But for volunteers that are minors, there is supposed to be adult supervision. If the council wants staff to bring back some options, that is certainly something that we can do. I don't have a proposal for you at this time, but we can look into some various options and bring that back for your consideration.
Yeah, I'd like to see something like that. Some other options maybe to kind of consider, so the Cub Scouts, something that would at least consider what they're trying to accomplish, right, is to adopt roads. And again, under the appropriate number of supervision that we deem fit, but something to maybe accommodate that.
Yeah, Mr. Mayor, we don't want to turn this into an agenda item right at this point, but the best way to approach this at this point is that when it comes to council comments, if it's the desire to the council direct staff to look into this, we can do that.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Can I say one more thing?
Sure.
Right, that, with respect to the legitimate concerns that staff has, certainly they're valid. We're Cub Scouts. We've got the environment. We don't trample it. I could probably make arguments that my kids will do a better job of not trampling the bushes than some of the adults that will go through. We are insured through our charter organization, Adams Point Church. We are insured through Boy Scouts of America. We pick up trash for them. And we have to do it. So literally, if we can't do it here, I have to take my kids to Norco or Ontario to pick up trash. And I'm not going to be happy, but it's a requirement. We have to do this. So we appreciate your time.
Thank you, Mr. D'Antoni. Councilman Rush, did you have something?
I'll address it in council comments. I think we can work it out, and I have some ideas. So,
thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Our last speaker is Rachel Gonzaga.
My name is Rachel Gonzaga, District Director for Assemblyman Mr. Montez. I'm just here to provide a brief legislative update and then also to inform you that we will be hosting an event here in Isabel, so just wanted to make you all aware. As far as legislation goes, I believe it's already been mentioned, but the Assemblywoman has introduced AB 91. This would allow use of the carpool lane in Riverside County on the 91 freeway during non-peak traffic hours. In addition, she has introduced AB 226. What this would do would require the State Commission on Teacher Credentialing to give priority to applicants of spouses of our U.S. military service members. According to a Department of Defense study, teaching is the most common career for military spouses, and military spouses have an employment rate of 23%, so we're hoping this will help address that issue and also address our teacher shortage that we're facing in California. In addition, she has introduced a bill that would allow for a telepsychiatry referral pilot program, and that's to assist women who are suffering from maternal mental health, whether that be postpartum depression and those kind of items. In regards to the event that we will be having, we will be hosting a California Competes Tax Credit Workshop that will be taking place at the Eastville Community Center. Sorry, I really shouldn't have this poster. That will be taking place at the Eastville Community Center. What we're trying to do is we're hoping to do more outreach to small, medium-sized businesses that are interested in expanding and offering a tax credit. We'll be providing step-by-step for the application process. There's $68 million available in lending, and we want to bring that to our region, so anyway we can help. I will be sure to have flyers at the next meeting, and we'll provide that information to Daniela as well. Other than that, in total, the member has introduced 9 pieces. So looking forward to continuing our work together. Thank you.
Thank you. What was the first bill that you mentioned again?
Sure. The, in regards to the carpool lane?
What was the number?
AB 91. And then the teacher credentialing for military spouses is AB 226.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Excellent. I'll move on to item 7, the consent calendar. Has anybody requested to pull anything?
So move.
Second.
Councilmember Platt?
Yes.
Councilmember Rigby?
Aye.
Councilmember Rush?
Aye.
Mayor Pro Tem Larmont?
Aye.
Mayor Tesetta?
Aye.
Motion passes 5-0.
Move on to item 9, council business.
Mayor Tesetta?
Yes, sir.
I would like to continue item 9.1 to our next council meeting.
Can I get a motion?
Motion.
Second.
Did you want that tabled or?
Continue.
Oh, you said next meeting.
Continue.
Okay.
Yeah.
Continue.
Councilmember Bob?
Yes.
Councilmember Rigby?
Aye.
Councilmember Rush?
Aye.
Mayor Pro Tem Larmont?
Aye.
Mayor Tesetta?
Aye.
Motion passes 5-0.
Move on to 9.2, our short-term tenancy ad hoc committee update, and provide direction to staff.
Good evening, Honorable Mayor and Council Members. This item is being brought back to you this evening per your request. At the January 11th City Council meeting, City Council unanimously voted in favor of the establishment of an ad hoc committee. At that time, you had asked to bring this item back for discussion on whether or not to make that committee subject to the Brown Act. At that time, the City Council collectively designated council members Todd Rigby and Brandon Plott to serve as the City Council representatives on the ad hoc, and Mayor Tesseri was selected as the alternate in the absence of one of the primary council members. I won't kind of recap on the purpose of the ad hoc. The purpose of this agenda item is specifically to determine whether or not the council members wish to make the ad hoc committee subject to the Brown Act. Due to Brown Act requirements, no more than two council members may serve on an ad hoc committee at any given time. In consideration for whether or not to make the ad hoc committee subject to Brown Act compliance, the council should be aware of a few rules. With the Brown Act, all meetings must be noticed just like city council meetings. That means there would be agenda items, minutes, be published on the city's website, open to the public, publicly accessible, and all of the members of the committee would be required to file a Form 700, which is part of the Fair Political Practices Commission requirement. And that form does require the release of the participants' financial information, and that is public record. An ad hoc committee, which is not subject to Brown Act, is more informal in nature. It can meet anywhere at any time, although the council previously established that this ad hoc committee would be meeting during regular business hours. Under this format, the meetings are not open to the general public, and agenda items are not, a formal agenda is not required. The committee is required to give reports to the city council on a regular basis until the jobs or duties that were originally assigned to the ad hoc committee are completed and the committee is abolished. Some of the stakeholders that were identified and requested to participate in ad hoc committee were HOA management representatives, representatives from California Apartment Association, KB Homes, and or other residential developers as needed, representatives from the Lewis apartment communities, and city staff. The council had already determined that no more than two residents would serve on the ad hoc committee. This is in an effort to keep the meetings manageable, efficient, and effective. City Council did direct staff to open up a volunteer application process, which closed today at noon. And City Council members Todd Rigby and Brandon Plott are in the process of reviewing those applications. The scope of the ad hoc committee would be specific to short-term tenancy and maternity tourism. The ad hoc committee will meet on an as-needed basis at City Hall during normal business hours. The first meeting date would be determined once the committee is established and dates are suggested by the council members. So at this time, I'm open to answer any questions, but we are looking for direction on whether or not the council wishes to make this ad hoc committee meet the compliance requirements for the Brown Act.
Mayor Pro Tem Leywa, anything? Councilman Plott?
I have a question. Just for clarification purposes on the ad hoc committee, as you said, compared to being subject to the Brown Act versus not being subject to the Brown Act, that it wouldn't be open to the public. With it not being open to the public is, would they still be allowed to attend that ad hoc committee meeting?
Yes, Councilman Rigby, you can make that as a stipulation to allow the public to attend those. It's just a more informal environment.
Okay. Thank you.
Just to clarify, so that would mean it wouldn't be posted But people would be welcome to attend.
That's correct.
Okay.
Right. Right. And it wouldn't be operating on a formal basis that we are right now.
Correct. Thank you. Councilman Rush?
No.
Yeah, I would, due to the sole fact that it's going to put an extra burden on our limited staff as it is, I would not want it to be to fall under the Brown Act.
I'll make a motion to not put under the Brown Act. That's possible.
Yeah, I just want to clarify one thing, is that this subcommittee by itself right now is not subject to the Brown Act.
Yeah.
Because what you're doing is as I indicated earlier when you were considering creating it, is that in order for it not to be subject to the Brown Act mandatory, it has to be for a short-term duration and it's got to be on a limited basis. So the subject matter has to be very specific, and it has to be a short-term, if you will, life of the ad hoc committee. Once that's been established, and you have established that, because this is going to be of a short-term nature, probably 6 to 9 months maybe, and it's going to be a particular subject matter, which you've already indicated, that by law wouldn't be subject to Brown Act. But you always have the option to make it subject to the Brown Act. So right now it is not. The discussion you would have is, do you want it to be?
And just before we move on, did we get any comment cards on this item?
Yes, we received one public comment card from Kathy Johnson.
All right, my apologies. I want to go ahead and open it up for the public comment.
Mr. Mayor.
That's okay.
Yes, sir.
I guess I do have some comments. I guess I've been here the longest. Yeah, I have.
I feel old.
We've done several ad hoc committees, and even though I think this is, has a higher degree of importance and scrutiny and is dealing with a much more real issue than some of the other things we've dealt with, City Hall relocation, things of that nature, I think, staff, our limited staff has a lot to do. Not to say that we're trying to be untransparent, but it just increases the level of reporting and burden. I think the ultimate goal, as I understand it and see it, is to bring the parties together and offer the resources and ability of staff and of the city to those entities, to all those other parties, to try to solve this problem. That's the ultimate goal. And so I would agree with Councilmember Plott. And also just to address, the timing issue of it also. The later we do things and more specialized we make them, just, drain staff, and we're already putting a tremendous amount of effort from an enforcement perspective on this as well. So, I think let's make it as streamlined as and efficient as possible. Get everyone to the table and try to solve this issue as quickly as possible. So,
thank you. Ms. Johnson.
Good evening, Mayor and council members. I just have two quick items. One is just on the name of the ad hoc committee. I noticed we're calling it, the city has chosen to call it short-term tenancy and for tourism. And I just want to state that short-term tenancy doesn't really apply at all to the birthing home issue, because that traditionally means 30 days or less of renting, which is never the case with these birthing homes. So that's just something to consider, so we're clear on what the committee is about. On the other point I need to make tonight is that my committee and I are concerned, my little grassroots committee of residents are concerned about the level of code enforcement going on in our city right now. We understand there were 1.5 positions up until December, when one code enforcement officer was let go, and she, of course, was a full-time officer. So I'm not clear. I think we do have Andy Shuck as our new full-time officer, but we're back down. Our numbers of hours have decreased. So there's just a concern there that this issue is still getting the attention it deserves, along with all the other issues the city has to deal with. We noticed a lot of communication early on with our former code enforcement officer. She was very open with members of the community that we're dealing with, that had complaints, that had an open investigation. And that obviously has been reined in. Things have changed a lot since she's been gone. We've been told that these are confidential issues now. Nothing can be told to us. Any information is confidential regarding an open investigation. And I understand that you're tightening things up and you're going by the book, and I understand that. I would just ask that that same sort of treatment is given to all code enforcement investigations now. So whether it's a burning house issue or somebody has trash in their front yard, I would hope that this would be equally enforced, that we would not be saying, somebody on staff might say on Facebook, we don't have to worry about that because they just moved in. And so we're giving them our time. See, that would be a breach of your own rules and regulations, right? So we would hope that this would be equitably enforced, that we're not being like shut down or set aside, but that we're being treated the same as everybody else.
Thank you. It's my understanding where the interviews were being conducted for a new code enforcement officer.
Mayor Tesseri, we are wrapping up the background investigation for a potential hire for a full-time code enforcement officer. Andy Shuck is currently serving as a full-time code enforcement officer. I'd also like to state that we have two volunteer officers. We also have Chris Sapp, who is an additional quarter of an officer that works only on Saturdays. We also have administrative staff, and now we have a street sweeping enforcement officer that is also in code enforcement. So at this point, there's about 7 people in code enforcement. Okay. And we're recruiting 6 people, and we're recruiting for for another officer. So. And that also did not include admin staff, so we have an admin person as well.
And some of the issues aren't necessarily, not to obfuscate, defer our responsibilities, but I mean, some of the things we shut off to JCSD, you know, if it's a trash issue or right-of-way issue, we'll call waste management, things of that nature.
Correct. So there are some issues that are submitted to code enforcement that are quick fixes, and there are some issues that take a much longer, lengthy investigation. Someone reporting illegal dumping, that comes into code enforcement, and that is quickly resolved through collaboration with waste management and or our public works department. Those issues, if they come in through the eCitizen app, the reporting party does get some kind of a notification of how that process is working through to resolution.
I know.
Me too.
Or I should say my wife knows.
And other complaints that come into code enforcement are referred to the appropriate department. They may or may not be code enforcement complaints that can be addressed at code enforcement level.
And on average, just in general, do you know off the top of your head how many reports we get a week? I don't call them complaints per se, but notifications?
Actually, that's a great question. For the eCitizen app, it's about 5 complaints per day submitted through eCitizen. But if you include walk-in complaints and telephone complaints, we're looking at probably an additional 15 that come in to City Hall and then get routed.
20, 25 a day, possibly 120, 150 a week?
Probably not that many. Obviously, on a Monday, there's a little bit more. There's a lull in the middle of the week, and then Thursday, it's usually quieter. Most of the peak is on Monday, Tuesday. Mm-hmm. But it's, I would say, about 15 to 20 complaints per day.
Wow. Okay. Thank you.
And as I said, some of them require a much more lengthy and time-consuming ongoing investigation to resolve.
Thank you. Anybody?
Do you have the direction?
Yeah, I need a motion with the direction for the ad hoc committee.
So you may want to help me on this, Mr. Kavanaugh. So I can motion to basically not, I don't want this ad hoc committee to be subject to the Brown Act.
Yes.
And that's what I'm motioning.
Yes.
Okay. Then I'd like to make a motion that the ad hoc committee not to be subject to the Brown Act.
Second.
Councilmember Scott?
Yes.
Councilmember Rigby?
Aye.
Councilmember Rush?
Aye.
Mayor Pro Tem Lorimer?
Yes.
Mayor DeSarri?
Aye.
Motion passes 5-0.
With that, we will move on to item 9.3, the Limonite Avenue interchange at Interstate 15. This aesthetic treatment and community identification update.
Thank you, Alia. This evening, I'm providing an update to City Council regarding Limonite Avenue interchange at Interstate 15 for the aesthetic treatment and the community identification update. Limonite Avenue interchange at Interstate 15 project is making steady progress despite the funding challenge. In March 2016, the project received approval of environmental document and project report. It is now well within the plan specification and estimate phase. On September 28, 2016, staff presented to City Council for discussion and direction a proposal for from City of Hurupa Valley to add community identification on the bridge facade. Upon discussion, the Council directed staff to hold a coordination meeting with the project design team and the City of Hurupa Valley. The meeting should include two members of City Council from both cities. Two meetings have been held. The first one is November 2016 at the county offices between the City of East Valley and Project Design Team, which includes Caltrans representatives, Richland County, who is the project manager for this project, and city staff. Representative City of East Valley was Mayor Pro Tem Maury Moore and Councilmember Ross. Separate design options were presented, including the Urban Valley original proposal, which includes the wagon wheel. Quickly, all parties agreed that we have a real design on the fence should be removed, and we should move back or go back to. So we should refer back to the design, which is the outline. Line.
I can hear you.
And during the meeting, also it was decided that the letter, the lettering of the city should be added on instead of etched on the bridge deck or bridge facade. And then that the identification of the city should be included on both sides of the bridge, the northbound facing and southbound facing, and on each side of the city should bear the city's name. A follow-up meeting was done on was held on January 19, 2017, after the design team made the necessary changes as requested. Mayor Pro Tem Maury Moore was there along with City Manager Mason and staff. More design renderings were presented, which is much better than the previous one, which mostly addressed all issues brought up at the previous meeting. This past Monday of this week, a subcommittee of the Limonite 15 interchange have held a meeting in the City Hall. Represented by, Mayor Tem Maury Moore, Councilmember Rush, members of Planning Commission and Public Safety Commission, city staff. We discussed this rendering before you. We tried to make as big as we can, but apparently it's still not very clear. But the first one is
the left one is a font alternative, which is a script font, Rubber Valley and Eastvale. The second one is a city font. It's not very clear out here because of the, but as you can see in your presentation or in your package, these are the two options that were presented at the subcommittee meeting, and also presented the lighting, which is behind this. But before we go there, I just want to present this as this presented tonight. Because of the add-on nature of the lettering, the cost of this option is more than the one that was previously presented to the council, just edge of the concrete. It's going to cost $150,000 per city to redesign the construction. And for the ongoing maintenance, just in case there is some graffiti on the bridge or the lettering has to be revised or modified due to any damage, the cost of for the maintenance per occurrence is about $50,000. Funding for this cost will be obtained from Measure A fund. And let me just show you the lighting portion of this project. Before you tonight is to provide direction to the city staff. Number one is to select which option that is presented before you tonight that you would go with. And depending on the selection that we have, and staff is going to work with the design team and city for Alex. That concludes the presentation, and staff may answer any questions.
Mayor Pro Tem.
So for the street lighting one, from here it's hard for me to see. I don't know if everybody else out there can see. On the lower left, in terms of light illumination, the street lighting, that's the same as Joe stated, as the lighting option is the same as what you see over on River Road on the bridge there. And down at the bottom, between the two script choices, the script font versus the city font. The city fonts, it turns out that both Eastvale and Herpa Valley, if you go on, it's actually the same font that both cities adopted. So the one on the left-hand side, the script font, you'd recognize it if something similar is done out in the desert, over in Palm Desert area. So
Jefferson and the I-10 freeway.
Yeah, I-10. And I think that we've had some good discussions at the meetings with the county and with our neighboring city, Harupa Valley. One thing that I don't know if it was fully discussed, the lettering itself, it is a polished aluminum, I believe. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so it's not backlit. That's why there is a question of the lighting on there. So just putting those out there. But I think, well, we unanimously agreed at the subcommittee level on Monday on, as Joe stated, the city font and the street lighting. However, absolutely wanted to get everybody else's input. So that's why it's here tonight.
Councilman Plott?
Yeah, one question. Joe, I think you said 50,000, it was a $50,000 increase. I thought, I mean, unless I misheard you, but on the report, it says from 90 to 150,000. So it'd be a 60,000, is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay. And then this is taken out of the Measure A revenue, is that correct?
For the maintenance and for the construction and installation, we may use some of the funding, but for the maintenance, ongoing maintenance, we're going to use Measure A or general gas tax money.
Okay. And where do we know where we're at? I know on our expenses, or what we budgeted for expenses, like 1.8 million in out of that particular fund for the 2016-2017 year. Where are we at currently year to date on our expenditures for Measure A revenues? For Measure A expenditures.
We don't have the budget right now. It varies from year to year. We don't have that number right now with me. I can provide that for you.
Okay.
But if your question is that the average, it depends on the project that we have. But every year we have the street resurfacing project, we have run an overlay project, and mostly between $1.2 million every year we spend.
And I trust your fiscal response. I guess my question was that there's not an issue with just the increase of 60,000 in regards to our overall expenditures. Right. What we budgeted, there shouldn't be a problem.
It's not a problem.
Okay.
Yes. We have plans to have reserve.
Mayor Pro Tem?
Joe, if you could please put that number into context, how much is this bridge costing us?
Can you repeat that question?
How much is this bridge going to cost us overall?
The bridge is going to cost overall $68 million.
Okay.
Okay.
That's if we started today.
Yeah.
If we started today.
If we started today, yes. Perfect. 2 days cost.
Perfect. Thank you.
You said that they discussed about decreasing the size of the sign. Is that correct?
We're talking about the final detail of the design, and that the suggestion, just by looking, the committee said it looks a little too big compared to the bridge, so can you make it smaller? So this is something that staff are going to bring in again to the final design of the project.
Okay.
Councilman Rush.
Thank you. I think we've made good progress from the little bit of a snafu that we had back in October, November, and I'm pretty sure everyone's come to some agreement. And there's a silver lining here, because the direction we were going in the November meeting we had with two representatives from Caltrans, the senior person didn't speak much, but one of their landscape architects indicated that if any facade improvements or additional bells and whistles that we do actually integrated into the concrete, while they may look pretty, any maintenance, any weathering, chipping, graffiti, things of that nature have to be maintained or fixed from the roadbed. And so I think it was good that we went through this exercise, because their recommendation was to try to make sure that anything that we do, you can maintain and fix from the bridge itself. You can reach over, you can lower someone down. Otherwise, we're put in a situation where we have to close down a lane.
And that not only is on our cost and or Harupa Valley's cost, but a huge PR issue, notification, you know, issues of Carmageddon, things of that nature. So this is what they have done in the desert. Mayor Pro Tem Larimore and I go out there frequently. I don't necessarily notice it at night. This is a little bit of a different freeway on the 10 at night. You're driving 85 miles an hour and, you know, try not to get hit by an eagle or something. So, or you're driving 65 miles an hour and most people are driving 85. I forgot Scott was still in the room.
I saw the 10 Forbes.
You know, we are going to have more traffic here in the evenings going southbound, probably when it's darker. But I think, you know, we've got the lighting issue settled and we've gotten rid of these wagon wheels. So, but in context, you know, it is a drop in the bucket relative to the overall cost. Sitting in RCTC, Scott Road is moving forward. I want to make sure we're next and that we get this, you know, settled. I think our next meeting with the ad hoc committee or committee of the county is the 21st or 22nd. So hopefully at that point, and then I had a meeting with the county Monday on another issue and the transportation manager mentioned, you know, that right-of-way acquisition is almost complete for this. So we're almost there. We're still really short as far as the construction funding, but this is a marquee entrance to our community. So I think it's gonna look really good.
Thank you. Just for everybody's, for my own clarification, none of this money is coming out of the general fund.
Correct, sir.
Thank you. My personal opinion is it definitely can't be the script font because they don't teach cursive in school anymore. So I don't know, you know, our younger generations are not going to be able to read these signs. So
it's a 50s diner. Looks like you're walking to 50s diner.
Yeah. Yeah, most kids can't even sign their name. But anyway, so my preference, I like the split street lighting and the city font. That's my personal opinion.
With 100%.
Anybody else? I guess everybody agrees with me.
So you're differing from, because I think the recommendation is item number two.
Is it the street lighting? What was the reasoning behind the street lighting versus the others? Was there any
different options
discussion, just what they liked?
So there was there was lots of discussion on lighting. It was actually kind of ridiculous, but also once we started talking about it, it was interesting. But each one of these different options, the lighting there, that another thing that I failed to mention, and I don't know if I remember correctly, those pictures on the bottom, those are, I believe, they're to scale and where they would place the street lights or the lighting itself. The problem with where it's showing in that diagram there of how much the signs are going to show reflection or not is that those street lights, they're going to be casting down and they're going to be hitting parts of the name. So those aren't exactly, from my understanding, perfect representations, although that was the intent to do that. But the different lighting, so the no overhang lighting, it will be good from the freeway for people driving. They're going to see that, and it's going to look nice. The street lighting one matches the one on River Road, and it is going to be good for the people on the bridge itself and possibly cast some light down onto the lettering on for people to see on the freeway. The top, the split street lighting, and it's a small picture, but it takes the same street lighting one and takes the one on the freeway and pushes it closer down to the sign. And the last one was one that they came up with after the fact, and that's putting it on the bridge itself. It's going to be much. It's going to be more expensive, but it's going to absolutely make the. It's going to be more expensive, but it will make the sign very bright. And anyway, there was lots of discussion about even it being too bright, all these options, but comparing it to other interchanges, but it's not apples to apples because those areas that they were mentioning were a little bit more rural than ours, and we have light pollution from both sides of the freeway. So anyway, I don't know if I'm answering your question, Todd.
No, you are. And off of that lighting, you bring up a good point that with it being a street lighting, it's not going to illuminate the whole sign. It may just be certain letters, correct?
That's my understanding, but I...
Well, what the intent actually, Councilman Rigby, is not to illuminate the whole signs, because you understand all these lights are spaced not in the same spacing, and then even the letters, the length of Ruba Valley and Eastvale, they are not the same length. They have two words and we have only one word. So all this has been considered, and then based on that consideration, and also based on the light shed from the shopping centers and the freeways, on both sides of the freeway, we believe that we don't need to have option number 4, which is planting the light right on the bridge deck, shining for the sign. Because unless you put the sign right in front of the letters itself, the effect, like Council, a member of them, Lori Moore, explained, is going to happen. So some is going to be bright, some is going to be like darker. So we just cannot have everything unless we have a tube lights. It's long tube lights, which not going to aesthetically look pleasing. So these are the challenges we have. And based on that discussion, the committee agreed to suggest that option number 2, the street light, is sufficient at this point. And also at night, the headlights of the vehicles, of the cars, will be somewhat shedding some of the lights to that bridge, and then maybe can would give them a look of the street name, the city name.
If I may also add to reiterate, the letters are made of brushed, some form of brushed steel, so they're already they're not truly reflective like the signs on the freeway that tell you, the Limonite exit is coming up, but the letters on the affixed to the bridge deck will be of brushed aluminum or brushed steel, so they will have a reflective quality already. Similar to a polished iPhone. So
well, and when just to compare this to where we were at with the concrete etching, that was much more of a muted approach in concrete with no reflectivity, and I think kind of tucked in. So I think from a visibility standpoint, we've come a long way.
Correct. And also for the benefit of the public, for those that don't know, the middle of the I-15 freeway is the boundary between the city of Eastvale and Eureka Valley. So that is why each city has their respective names on half of the bridge.
It's pretty much self-evident when you drive down the freeway anyway. If you look to the left, you can tell that's Eureka Valley. If you look to the right, that's a lot better. So.
Be nice.
That's a mayor speaking right there. That's good. That's a true mayor right there.
I'll entertain a motion.
I'll second.
No, I'll entertain one.
Oh.
You got one?
Yeah, well, I say we'll go motion with exactly what Councilmember Rush, the recommendation of the I-15 Interstate Committee had chose to go with the street lighting and the font number 2.
Second.
Councilmember Plott?
Yes.
Councilmember Rigby?
Aye.
Councilmember Rush?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Warren
Moore?
Aye.
Mayor
Giuseppe?
Aye.
Motion passes 5-0.
All right. We'll move on to 9.4, the Regional LED Streetlight Program and Western Riverside Council of Governments.
Good evening again, Honorable Mayor and Council members. This is the presentation for Regional Streetlight Program. Western Riverside Council of Governments. I would like to welcome representatives of WRCOP tonight, the Society of Master Program Manager, and Ms. Anthony Segura. They are here with us to answer any questions later on. I want to give a brief um, I'm going to give a brief background. On December 2014, Nabiar Box Executive Committee directed staff to develop a regional streetlight program on behalf of the jurisdictions, member jurisdictions. And on October 2015, Nabiar Box staff initiated regional LED streetlight program to basically identify the feasibility of one, acquire streetlights ownership from SCE, from Edison. Number two is to retrofit streetlights into LED. Currently, we have HPS, which is high pressure sodium, or LPS, low pressure sodium, depending on where it's located. On July 2016, Mr. Tyler Messers, who is here tonight, presented a program overview to Eastdale City Council. It's attached to your package. And on September 6, 2016, Rabia Cog Executive Committee selected Bank of America for acquisition and retrofit financing for the program. This is just a background here. Between October and December 2016, Rabia Cog has conducted several LED demonstration events in the city of Hemet. And subsequently, after the program started, in October 2016, Rabia Cog conducted community survey. And 91% of the survey favored retrofit to LED. And believe it or not, 77% of this response came from Israel residents. So if you want to know the number, it's 548 total respondents, 420 coming from Israel. Go Israel. The question is now, why we acquire the streetlights? Number one, if we leave SCE the way it is right now, SCE has no plan nor interest to retrofit the LED lights, even if we requested that. Perhaps, this is just perhaps, number one is due to high capital cost of retrofit. Number two, because they're going to lose money, because reduced revenue of the LED. Consumed energy is much less than HPS or LPS. The acquisition opens up to a jurisdictional retrofit opportunity. Individually, collectively, depending on the decision of each member of the jurisdiction. And also, why we acquire is because LED enhances public safety. Number one is brighter and more focused. We can flip to the next slide, please. And as you can see here, the left one, this is the same street in Hemet, and the left one is LED streetlight. And it's brighter, it's more white, the color. And the right one, if you can see, is regular streetlight, which is HPS or LPS. Now, on the left one, the LED, you can see that the light is shining on the pavement, on the roadway, less on behind the roadway itself. While the regular streetlights is sharing the lights behind the roadway, in many different instances in residential area, these are homes where people live. So we receive complaints sometimes, from time to time, people say the streetlight is too light, so what they have to do, you have to either turn the head a little bit or put some kind of panel lens. And also, if you can see the coverage, the throw, we call it, of the light, the left one is just a brighter and then bigger a throw than the regular lights we have. These are the spectrum of the color that was handed over. I attended the demonstration area. This is like a rainbow in the spectrum of the color area. And we put the left one is under the LED street lights. You can see all the colors. And right is we put it under the HPS. The whole thing looks gray. Just a dark gray, lighter gray. The whole thing is just gray. It doesn't show all the colors. So it enhances the spectrum of the color itself. LED uses less energy. That means cost of the utility is going to be reduced. LED lasts longer, the lamp lasts longer. I would say between 3 to 5 times as long as HPS or LPS. And its O&M cost, replacement cost, is going to be low, less. And LED also allows us to have the smart city opportunity because on top of the head of the street lights, we can add the device to your right. There is almost, this one here is like a dimmer. We can use to dim the light if we wish to do so. But this can also be used as a transmitter for wave of the telecommunication waves. It's almost like the repeaters of the wave of the telephone communications. okay, this could be a revenue generating potential in the future if we choose to do this. There's a technology for this, it's still evolving, but there is a good opportunity that we can do that in the future. Why we acquire? Because we have these comparisons. The left is the LS1, the current life that we have. All these numbers are taken from the average that the WRCOG team has done, the average lights that is being paid for a residential local streets. $12.97 per light per month. Okay, the blue one is the energy cost and the operations, this LS1 program. Let me explain LS1. LS1 is the program that SCE would own the light, they would pay for the maintenance. If the light got hit, if the lamp got burned, they're going to pay for that. We're going to call them. It's going to take them 3 days to maybe 2 weeks to replace that. They're going to come replace that at this cost. They are not going to charge anymore. Now, we are trying to shoot for LS2, become city-owned. There's a right chart right there. This is a city-owned LS2 light. And also the assumption here on this picture is that we are also retrofitting to LED. Okay, so we are comparing HPS and LPS, both are, the right one is LED. As you can see, the saving per light per month is about $8 per light per month. Okay, it's a, and then, it is if we acquire and we retrofit the lights to LED. Yes, next please. The streetlights within Eastvale boundaries. I want to give you a little a snapshot of what's happening here. We have about 4,039 streetlights. All are owned by SCE in the city of Eastvale right now. Now, if you look at the number on your report, show 4,078. That's an error because all this document is still preliminary. So I apologize for that. So all these lights, 4,039 out of this, 4,027 out of these lights are managed by GCSD. GCSD, who assumes responsibility number one as legal guardian, I call it, because since Eastvale became a city of incorporated 6 years ago, 6.5 years ago, GCSD already taking care of this. The county apparently asked GCSD to take care of this in 1990s, late 1990s. The first LLMD, Landscape Lighting Maintenance District in Eastvale, was formed in 1998, so almost 20 years ago. So it's been happening. So when we became a city, this is not our priority. So we let it go all the time. And number two, GCSD assumes a role as streetlight administrator to assess Eastvale residents for O&M costs. So the $12.97 appears on all your tax bills. It shows that you pay that much for light. Of course, it is spread with among the residents. We verify this number from the annual report from GCSD online, and we also verify this report from a couple of tax rolls of the Eastern residents. Streetlight liaison agency has also been assumed by GCSD because when they collect the assessment, they will deal with SCE to pay the bills, monthly bill, for the energy and cost based on $12.97 per light. Now, this $12.97 per light is only for residential street. If you go to Limonite, to Hamner, Citrus, all these larger lights, brighter lights, the cost can go up to $16 per light per month. So the average is about $13.50 per light in Eastvale. Now, out of these 4,000 lights, only 12 of them are not owned, but managed by the city of Eastvale. Location of these lights, number one is around Eastvale Gateway Center on Hamner and Limonite, and the second one is on Hamner and Riverside. There's about four lights out there. We don't know why when those developments were occurred, being developed, county decided to give it to Eastvale, I guess, or maybe someone decided that Eastvale would take care of that. It was like 10 years ago, I think. Okay, now the options for the council tonight is to consider option A, which is do nothing. Just leave it alone like this, what it is right now. Option B is to acquire only Eastvale managed streetlights, which is 12 poles, and encourage ACSD to do the same with most of the poles, which is 4,000 lights, 27. And option C for the City Council to acquire all 4,039 poles, including under GCLC's managed. So this whole thing is going to be taken over by Eastvale as ownership. These options, option B, which is acquiring only 12 poles, we have less flexibility on future usage of the remaining lights in the 4,000 lights. We only have, you can hang banners on the 12 lights, you can do, well, we have obviously some agreements with other, with GCSD, but flexibility of future use of these lights is very limited. We have more operation maintenance process time due to third party involvement, because now we have GCSD who's still maintaining and then managing that if we let them acquire from SCE. And not economical, because the economies of scale, we, based on the cash flow that will be shown here, at after 20 years of cash flow, we are about $50,000 in negative. Because of the only 12 lights, we're going to manage that, we're going to take over. And also, we're missing opportunity in the future to add smart city transmitters. This transmitter, basically, we can rent, we can lease to AT&T, Time Warner, to whoever. So in addition to what they have, the cell towers, they can use repeaters on top of the lights rather than building another tower in the city. Option C, that to acquire all 4,039 poles, would show a positive cash flow of $360,000 on year one alone. Okay, and the cumulative positive cash flow at the end of 20 years is going to be $3 million. And but option three, we need to enter an agreement with AGCSD. Number one, to ask GCSD to continue the administration LLMD. They've been doing it for 20 years. This is a switch here. Number two is to transfer the collected LLMD assessment to the East of the city. So they will continue to collect the assessments, and they will transfer that twice a year to the city. And the city would use this money to pay for all the stuff that I'm going to explain a bit later here. And then we may participate in WRCO financing program through BFA, which already took place. And also the future O&M program, the regional O&M operation and maintenance program that WRCO is going to do. Or we may pursue our own Eastvale own program, both financing or O&M. So it's not mandatory we join WRCO. So these are the options that we can choose. Again, this is the cash flow information. Apologize again for the lettering is so small. But let me just read from my information here. We have assumptions based on this. The first slide that I'm showing here, this is only Eastvale lights, based on 12 lights that we're going to acquire from SCE. Based on this, we are going to, it's going to cost us $15,000 for this 12 lights acquired, so about $1,000, $1,200 per light. And it's going to cost us $25,000 to retrofit, because it's going to cost about $2,200 to retrofit from the high pressure into LED. This is again economy of scale. We have that. And then it shows on the second item, let me go with the assumptions again here. This assumption is based on 4.65% interest rate, and we have included the inflation for the O&M of 3% per year. So we included the admin inflation for 3% a year, and the rate of energy costs based on the past 15 years, SCE has increased the rate 4% per year. So we included that rate increase into this calculation that we have. The average useful life of this light is about 15 years, so replace every 15 years. And also the loan with Bank of America is 15-year loan. It's not a 20-year loan. The cash flow summary is the next item on the presentation here. But let me just jump to the last item, which is the big cash flow here. You can see that at the end of 20 years, we have negative $53,000 if we choose this option. Let me go to the next option, option three, option C.
Joe, if I could just restate something. In this particular scenario with just the 12 poles, there is no economies of scale. And that's going to be the big difference between just purchasing 12 versus trying to purchase the whole lot. We see the significant savings in the larger economies of scale with the 4,000 plus street lights.
If council has any question, I can stop and pause here and meet you later. I'm sorry to keep talking. So, you guys, do you want me to continue? Go ahead.
Yeah, I would say I'm good just till you finish. And,
after, okay, yeah, right. So option C, one item that is important to note is that on the right column, LED retrofit cost per pole is $365. This is based on 4,000 poles. You can compare that with the previous one, $2,200 per pole to retrofit. Again, like City Manager Nissen explained, this is the economy scale that we have here. So based on this, if you can flip two pages down, we are showing the net savings, a cumulative net savings after the 20th year of $3 million. And this is after we included on this table here, we have O&M cost of about $50,000 and increasing all the way based on 3% increase per year. And then we have financing payment of $440,000 for 15 years. This is the mortgage. And then we have the relamp service, which is the reserve of $150,000 per year. After the year nine, we trying to build up the reserve there. And we are still ahead of $3 million at the end of 20th year. So based on this information that I provided, we concluded that collective assessment is sufficient to pay for financing, to purchase the lights, and also to retrofit, is sufficient to pay for O&M cost, and is also sufficient to add reserves to the account. And these reserves, in 20 years, we have the $3 million, these reserves would help stabilize the future assessment rate of either based on the O&M cost or based on the rate increased by LCE. We expect this to be enough and sufficient to buffer for that in the future. And also, of course, potentially, there is a long-term potential to decrease the LMB assessment to residents at the end of that, at certain year. And we don't have that information yet. That concludes my conversation.
Yeah, I just wanted to add with the $3 million surplus, if you will, at the end of 20 years, that is something that could be used as a rate stabilization fund to plan for offsetting future increases in utility costs. And at the same time, I'd like to mention that because these are paid through the taxes, this is not something that could be, you know, that $3 million could not be moved over to the general fund and be used to pay for anything else. So it would have to stay with streetlights. So I just wanted to put that out there in case anyone is wondering.
Do we have any public comments? Councilman Rush.
Thank you. I would first like to recommend that any items that require detailed financials we put at the beginning of the agenda. A lot of information. I think it makes, you know, generally I like the concept and I think it makes sense financially. I see Mr. Corbin walked in and I'm curious to hear what the district's opinion is on this, and obviously just the 12 lights doesn't provide a lot of benefit. To Ms. Nissen's comments, you know, the surplus is all well and good, but if the residents are now, you know, in this scenario now paying more than the cost of operation, my opinion is that should go back to the residents. So I don't see, I mean, from the efficiency standpoint, I think it makes sense. Taking out city versus JCSD bifurcation issues, the security, I mean, this is a financing mechanism. I don't know how similar it is to the HERO program, but I guess that's what I'll use as the analogy.
Is the security being held by the streetlights itself? So, I mean, you mentioned, you used the word mortgage several times. There's a financing mechanism. What security is backing up that financing mechanism? Maybe if Tyler has that information. And then who is holding the bag, so to speak? Is it WRCOG? Is it the individual jurisdictions? Who's holding the liability? You're welcome.
So as we began identifying a lot of the financial institutions that are out there for the streetlight acquisition retrofit, we chose Bank of America. One of the questions that we were asking a lot of those institutions is that very question. What would you require as collateral? And Bank of America, one of the flexibilities that they're allowed for this direct lease form lending is just the street. The streetlights are the only collateral. You don't have to put a city hall or any of the other subsidies that
have. We don't really have a city hall, but. Okay, and then are the financing agreed? I mean, because, you know, we mentioned the regional approach, which I think is key. Sorry, I can't talk anymore. But the individual financing agreements, would that be between the financier and the city? And if JCSD was involved, would there be a three-party agreement? Is WRCOG getting involved at all in the actual terms and conditions, or just being the facilitator? Okay. Mr. Mayor, I think it's all the questions I have at this point.
Councilman Rigby.
I just had a quick question regarding if something were to happen with the pole, as you were saying, that we would take liability on that now, such as if it got hit by a car, got knocked over. Now it's up to us to replace that, right?
You mean after the acquisition?
Yes.
Yes.
And was that cost taken into consideration in this, an estimated cost on that at all, or was there anything?
Yes, that cost is included in the operations and maintenance, okay. Capital for some of the pole replacements, as well as other replacements that might be needed in situations where a pole is not.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
And just I think that's something, a cost that we recapture through insurance, hopefully, if the person, because everybody's insured if they're driving a car. So.
Mm-hmm. So is that accurate, Lieutenant Forbes?
Yeah. It's a law.
Councilman Plott?
Yeah, I have. Councilmember Rush already answered probably half of my questions, but I had a lot. I kind of was looking over this earlier in the week and just kind of going through the different schedules. You know, option B doesn't necessarily, I mean, even if, let's say that we didn't finance and the city just took it out of the reserves and would never want to do that. But even if we did, it would still not make sense financially. It wouldn't be a good fiscal move. But my questions are more geared towards option C and then just kind of general questions. One thing that probably isn't considered in this, in the expenses that we could incur is that would we ever have to look at hiring maybe a part-time staff member? We're going to take over 4,000 lights in comparison to the 12 that we're doing. Would we have to allocate a part-time staffer to help pay for this as far as the maintenance and that ongoing? Or would this be something that JCSD would be under our agreement with them, or what we end up coming up with through the negotiations? Would they be responsible for that?
Okay, thank you for the question. Yes, we have to have additional staff time to take care of this, because now we have to take care of the billing payments on monthly or quarterly to SCE. We have to take the money in from JCSD and process that. And we have to take care of the O&M program, if we be part of that. With the Pay Bank of America, we be part of that. So all these items, this afternoon I have checked with finance staff and then I explained the magnitude of this. Finance staff said, currently the city is managing our own LLMB for traffic signals. Not all of them, but few of them. And then the process is more involved because this is our own LLMB, including the 12 that we own. So we have to do the annual reports every year, and we have to do the assessment role and then receive the money from the assessor's office every year and to pay for the billing for the energy costs. So this process has been going on in a smaller scale. So when we take this over, and then this is something that's going to happen with 4,000 lights, the process itself is quite the same, but similar, except that maybe more billing has to be processed. So I check approximately how much time and how much in dollar. The answer was about a quarter of staff time per year is going to be added, and it's equivalent to about $25,000 per year.
Okay. Thank you on that. I think this is more for the benefit of the public. I just want to, and also for myself, that I understand this is, I'm under the impression we're obviously going to be carrying this loan, and obviously it affects the way our balance sheet looks because it is a debt and a liability that we're assuming. Just so I'm clear, the new streams of revenue that we technically wouldn't be getting but would help pay off that loan is through the CFDs or the LLMDs. That would help pay off this loan, because the one thing I do like about option C is we're never in a negative, no matter what year you're in, we're always staying in the positive. Am I correct in that assumption?
Based on the cash flow, so yes.
Okay.
I have to add a little more if I may.
Yeah.
With all this program that we have, if we reduce consumption of energy, there is a program called RELP, where Edison will contribute some money or give you a rebate, give the city a rebate. At the second year, we receive a rebate for about $300,000 to $400,000. It is on the assumption here. We can flip. If you look at the bottom here, there is SCE. I can't even read that. Incentives to receive in year two. In the amount of $324,000. So there's a rebate that also helps with the positive cash flow.
Okay.
And this rebate would increase because our city manager mission is pretty big with this platinum, with this all realm. We almost reached platinum. I was told that if we reach that level, this number is going to grow for another, what, $50,000? Or half a million dollars? Or $50,000? So this is going to help us with the cash flow.
I think... Michelle kind of answered this question already, but again, this has nothing to do with the city's fund, obviously. It has to do with rate stabilization. It has to really bring back to the property taxpayers, or in this case, their special assessment taxes, that we could use to stabilize those so they don't increase. Is that, that's what this is all about, too, to make sure that's...
Yes, sir.
Okay. I do like option. I think it makes sense. It's smart. It's definitely smart decision down the road. There's a lot of perks to having better lighting, obviously with the situation of mailbox thefts and all that, just having better lighting. There's a lot of pros to that. Also additional revenue that we can get from selling repeaters or having repeaters on these light poles when we own them from Verizon or AT&T or T-Mobile, which that's something I would want to direct staff in the direction is to find out on average how much space can we actually rent out? What's the average of those? And again, I don't expect you to answer them, but down the road, you know, these are revenues that, you know, who knows what that could be. It could be anywhere from, you know, $20,000 a year to over $100,000+ a year, right? Something that we want to consider.
Ground lease is like $2,500 a month. I mean, for a facility, this is obviously smaller.
This is smaller, but it could be $200 a light pole.
Yeah.
You know, and you add so many light poles to strengthen that signal. Yeah, go ahead.
If we can allow, I believe Tyler has
let the professional know.
So we have received that question, kind of trying to quantify revenue generating opportunities. So what we have been working on is really just polling a lot of the cities and on the coast as well as a little more inland. And what we are finding, it's about $1,000, I think it's a good conservative ballpark at this point, $1,000 per pole. Now that means that's annual, correct? Right? Yes, sorry. $1,000 more annual. Your coastal cities sometimes see quite a bit more on peers and such, but I think for a more conservative number, we're ballparking right now $1,000 per pole for your telecommunications.
Okay. Out of the percentage of those poles, how many do you, I mean, if you were to say, I mean, how many of those poles are actually being utilized? Is it 10%, 20%?
That's a good question. I'm happy to get back to that.
Yeah.
So that on the number of how the city's inventory
looks like. Yeah, I say that because I think it's important in and I know we're not voting on an option to choose this, what we're going to go with. It's to further staff in the direction where they want to. I get that, but I think at the end result, I think that needs to be part of the equation to take into consideration. If it's minimal, if it's, you know, far more than minimal, so you know, those things. But thank you.
Councilmember Platt, with the telecommunications devices, for example, a repeater for Smart City, a signal booster, it depends on the equipment. Some of them throw a much larger radius than others. Okay. So, for example, Eastvale Community Park has a device there that throws to cover the entire park. Roosevelt has one, covers the whole school. So again, it depends on the intent of the person doing the leasing on how far they want it to throw to make the connections.
And then I have one more, and I apologize for so many questions.
No.
The big part of the big question here, and I think the really big question mark in all this, I think it has to be part of the decision, is we don't know, out of all the, I think there's 60 CFDs or LMDs, we don't know what the total combined revenue is right now, as of right now, right? We don't know what it is. I think part of making that decision, and this decision is, I think we need to know what that is. I think it's important to know that, one, because just to make sure there's a sufficient amount to make sure that we can pay off the loan of B of A, that we're getting sufficient revenue. So we don't know that number. Am I correct in saying that?
Well, no, because these assumptions that we're operating under, those were provided to us by WRCOG that did do the fact finding. Tyler, if I'm correct, this is based on data obtained from JCSD, Southern California Edison.
Okay.
And City. Is that correct? So we're working off, I mean, these aren't, I wouldn't say 100%, you know, this is take it to the grave, but this is fairly accurate data.
Based on the CQC rates, and given that the city's inventory, we kind of plug those in, given your inventory and CQC approved rates, we're pretty confident in the estimate. There might maybe a couple of polls that Edison or the company missed along the very close estimates.
Okay, so I guess My question again is the revenue from each CFD, or not each, but the total accumulation of each CFD, or the total accumulation of the CFDs, having that understanding, because I don't see it on there, but again, I
yeah, I have a customer plot. I have a couple of samples here, not samples, actually annual reports.
Yeah.
Of the JCSD LMB 98.2, that's almost the last one, the first one. And 2001-3. Just based on these two reports that I have, this is a sample of 96 plus about 550 lights out of 4,000 lights. Mm-hmm. They are consistently charging per light about $150 per year, so you by 12, about $12.50 per light just for the residential light. And for the larger light on Lyman Heights, Hamner, on arterial streets, they charge about $16 per light. This has been consistent for all those 500 lights. I'm pretty confident if we take other CFDs and collect this, and this is about the same rate that they have, so multiply by 4,000 lights, we're talking about 4,000 times 13, $520,000 or $52,000 per year, per month, and that's about like close to $600,000 per year annually that's been collected the revenue.
Okay.
Now, please understand that all this administration of the CFDs LLMDs include annual reports that they hire their consultants. This consultant prepared this, and the intent of this meeting is that we are not going to take it over from the from GCSD. GCSD is going to continue to take care of the administration of the LLMD.
Yeah, that and that would be my thing. Is that I'd rather keep JCSD, have them continually managing. I think that's would be a much smarter way to go, because obviously they're familiar with it as well. First, Joe, thank you. I'm done with my questions. I just want to say thank you. It's somewhat of a complex issue, broken down. There's a lot of different facets to it, but I think you've simplified it in a way that kind of, at least for myself, kind of understand it better. So thank you for that. And for me, I think it would make sense for us to at least look at option C and at least further in that direction to continue conversations down that road. That's all I have to say. I apologize for the time.
All right. So, there's one last thing I'd like to add. There is a expiration date on being able to exercise this option. So Southern California Edison gave a limited time period to take advantage of this. We've been in the pipeline with the feasibility study and discussions for some time now. And our expiration date was actually extended, and we have until the end of March to make a commitment that either way that we're going to do this. So this at this time, this is not to make a determination on financing options or anything. This is just to seek council direction on, do you even want staff to go down this path? We would, of course, bring back to you an agreement. We would bring back to you financing options to choose from. Additional discussion items would have to come forth. But at this time, we're seeking council direction on, do you even want to bother? Do you want us to continue down this path or not?
Councilman Larimore.
Yes. Thank you, sir. Let me see. With the lighting that was the choices that the picture that was shown, it seemed pretty drastic in terms of color differentiation, being able to see that. Would this help with public safety?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes. Maybe. Killed it.
Councilman Larimore, yes, it would assist with public safety. The using LED is a more natural light, as you saw in the grayscale example versus the color scale. This is something that when we do neighborhood watch and when we do review plans for the businesses, this is something that we preach is crime prevention through environmental design. And by having true natural colors in streetlights, we, instead of having, I'll give you an example, is we saw somebody running down the street wearing dark clothing. That's really not helping us. Right. When we find a guy three blocks away wearing dark clothing, versus with, then that's with the sulfur lights. With the LED lights, we get descriptions, different color shirt, different color pants, which we can use for prosecution when we do eventually identify someone. This is something that we preach it to businesses and to residents in their own homes. So we would recommend similar for the city.
Okay, excellent. Thank you for that. In that there is a difference in lumens, is that right, the correct terminology? Mm-hmm. Is this going to be too bright in some situations for some residents in residential areas?
Right. Thank you for the question. The question kind of broke down. The demonstration workshop that we did over the past, over the course of 3-4 months, is just to take care of that. Because we already introduced many different manufacturers of lights, of lamps, LEDs. Some are brighter, some are too bright, too large. And then unanimously, we pick certain color that is good for illuminating the streets, not shedding light to the homes. At the same time, also that is give more natural lights look of the community, and we have gone through that. And then there's a survey result that I've had over the share
But Joe, the lumens on a residential interior street is different threshold than the lumens on a major arterial.
Okay.
So if I recall correctly, Tyler, maybe you can tell me, they can be adjusted.
Okay. Excellent.
Yes, they can be all adjusted.
Right. I believe it's been answered, but I want to make sure we're not talking about buying trucks and having another and staff members to go and change these lights. I know that they are reliable, but still.
No, we... No, we are not looking to establish fleet services for this to be handled by the city. We can opt into WRCOG's maintenance program because they are also looking in forming a conglomeration in which all the cities would participate. Or we can outsource this to a third party.
Okay. And I wanted to follow up on Councilman Rush's comment or question for JCSD. Is this, you've been in communications, Todd, thank you for coming tonight on this. Is this something that JCSD is okay with? Have we talked to them about it at this point, or is it
yes,
talk to us
yes.
before we talk
no,
to them?
No. Okay. We've had several meetings with JCSD over the last year. Uh-huh. Our situation here in the city of Eastville was rather unique for WRCOG. I think we kind of threw them a curveball with the fact that we have a special district here that has all the streetlights for the 99% of them. Uh-huh. So we immediately engaged JCSD, and Tyler's had meetings with them. We've had meetings at City Hall. I want to say we've had probably four or five meetings. But Todd Corbin, general manager for JCSD, is here this evening. I don't mean to put you on the hot seat, Todd.
I do. Yeah.
Don't forget to fill out your comment card.
Since I've been at JCSD for the last 5 years, we've been advocating on behalf of the community to Southern California Edison to start to change out to this new technology within our service territory. A lot of the feedback we've received from SCE is, yes, that will happen, but it's on their own timetable, not on ours. Many of the streetlights in Eastville are much newer. The ones in Fruca Valley that we manage are quite a bit older, but their decision is not ours. We simply levy the tax to pay the bills, pay for the electricity, and pay for the maintenance. So this program, when it came forward, special thanks to city staff for even alerting it to us, because we are correct to know that we actually levied that tax. It certainly opened our eyes to an opportunity. Just to reiterate, all of the money that is spent on streetlights is paid by the property owners. If there are any excess or any reserves that goes back, we have a reserve policy. In fact, the last 2 years, property owners have been getting a rebate because of the level of reserve, the money that we have in reserves. They're managed not through CFDs, but through LMDs or LLMDs. So they're specific to a zone, they're specific to an area, unlike CFDs, which is a little bit different. And so we've got some issues. We've got issues where we have an LMD that encompasses part of the city of Eastville, part of the city of Fruca Valley, and how you split that up. And once you get into the details of it, it just becomes a little bit messy. So let me just reiterate, I think that the savings that we're talking about here is real. That money would go back to the residents and the property owners of Eastville, whether JCSD does it, or whether the city buys the streetlights. I think there's really no difference in the administration on that. However, if there are other income-generating opportunities, which is really the unknown. There's liability that comes along with ownership, but also opportunities. We're willing to sit down, as we have with other issues within the city, to collaborate and try to partner on those opportunities, because in the end, we can try to provide the best service possible. So we are prepared, I think, February the 22nd to take this issue to our finance committee, who also oversees our streetlight levies, and make a recommendation that there is significant interest across our territory to participate in the program. If the city is very interested in owning the poles themselves, I think there's just a lot more discussion and a lot more analysis that needs to happen of how the mechanics of that happens legally with GCSD having the levy, but also sending those payments back to the city. Because in the end, the decision on what happens on the poles resides with the owner of the poles. And so, in essence, the city would be making those decisions separate from the responsibility for the levy. And the levy only has a certain amount of capacity. The only way this program works is if you change out the light, existing lights to LEDs. Otherwise, there's not enough capacity in the existing levy without raising the levy to pay for those improvements. So we look forward to continuing to work with the city and provide whatever information we can to help you all and our board members make that final decision.
So, thank you. Yeah. I'm not sure if this is permissible, but if, let's say, for example, we didn't take over, is that something that's an option for JCSD?
Absolutely. I think it's really an issue for the jurisdiction too.
Okay. Like even the school district?
Well, I'd rather it be JCSD.
I'm just curious.
Second option would be the city because of the connection to the other opportunity.
Well, yeah, I was just going to ask that, and then probably for Tyler, because JCSD is not a member of WRCOG, so I was curious as to the participatory level, and if the city, you know, in some form or fashion needed to shepherd that forward. I mean, if we're just talking about dipping our toe in and investigating this process, I'm all for it. And let's get moving, you know, with all due haste. Obviously the devil's in the details, as we've seen with not only the LMDs, but the CFDs and everything, and you know, the layers upon layers from county to city. So I think those are issues we're going to have to work out eventually, but I agree with the general manager. The savings, I think, are real, and the opportunities are there definitely to do something exciting. I'm frustrated with Edison, you know, and their lack of interest, you know, being an energy provider. We could sit here for another 3 hours and, you know, poo-poo them, which is a little bit unfair because they're not here, but, you know, is it simply a money thing? Is it a capital improvement thing for them? Is it a matter of resources? I mean, they just opened up this Tesla plant, you know, so touting renewable energy and efficiencies and things of that nature on one hand. So,
Councilmember Rush, that is a discussion we had with Edison, because I brought that point up. You know, if you just would swap these out, this would be a moot point, and you could stay in the energy business.
Mm-hmm.
But they said the streetlights represents 1% of their total assets, so it is not their priority.
So from a technical standpoint, and if, you know, the poles that we own, JCSD owns, does anybody own anything? Does Edison own the poles? And so Edison owns... So is it, whoever acquires the poles, is it from ground to top? I mean, is it the entire structure?
Mm-hmm.
And then
no, but not the infrastructure. So the,
so, and then Edison will still provide the electricity,
correct,
to power them, obviously.
Correct.
And then procedurally or technically, is it just a matter of, is there any changes that need to be done to the element or the casing? I don't know exactly what it's called, but the fixture itself?
The street pole fixture itself,
correct.
It's my understanding that's not where the change takes place. It's going to be mostly the housing, the light housing, and the lamps, and it's just going to be the fixture, the head. But one thing, going back to Mayor Tesseri's question, could the school district own do this? No, because the school district doesn't own, they own their schools, but their street, their lights, liability for lights ends at the right of way. These are in our right of way. That is city property. So the devil is in the details, because you have JCSD collecting the assessments for an asset that Edison has that's in our public right of way.
But we could put banners on all the poles without doing a license agreement, right?
Exactly.
Yes, you could. Mm-hmm. Yes, you could. Absolutely. That is another benefit.
I think the conversion, obviously, what the lieutenant said about public safety, it is a big-time enhancement, in my opinion, especially for just regular pedestrian traffic. It would enhance the safety at the intersections when people are doing in the crosswalks in the middle of the night when nobody stops at a red light to make a right turn. So something as tragic as the incident at Limonite and Hamner may have been avoided because it might have been more well lighted. So I like this project.
Yeah. Also to consider the, I know we have a lot of citizens in Eastvale that have surveillance cameras. Mm-hmm. The quality of their footage would be improved by the lighting.
That's actually my compromise. That's what I do for a living. So yeah, absolutely. LED lighting is far better as far as the quality of your camera. So on your front porch, if you have a street light that's 40, 50 feet away from where your cameras are in your house, absolutely much better quality.
It would also
way better recognition.
Yeah. It would also act as more of a deterrent. You know, these cluster boxes, a lot of them might be better illuminated.
Yes.
Quick question is, Councilmember Rush briefly mentioned, would there be any kind of issue with JCSD still managing and levying these with not being a member of WRCOG?
Well, WRCOG has been very generous. There was a $10,000 fee to do this feasibility study, and they moved forward with that regardless of the fact that JCSD is not the member agency. We were. So we initiated. They've been very cooperative at this point, and Tyler, if you would jump in and correct me if I'm wrong, I believe JCSD would still be able to avail themselves to the financing should this rest with JCSD and other amenities to opt into WRCOG programs.
Also, if you add 6,000 poles to the entire program, it adds on the scale, so there's the and so if, especially also for us to consider, I think our board is, if Eastvale decides to do one thing, let's say you would like to own those poles, we've got a decision to make on the proof of balance side and what we do with those poles and how we split the LMDs that are.
The last point of consideration is that there would also need to be some kind of a policy decision from the council regarding everything coming up. So all future projects, we would need to make a determination on that. How are we going to continue along the same vein, which is to create an LMD and allow JCSD to manage it and collect the assessments? Otherwise, you can set it up from day one that the streetlights come to the city. So for example, the Goodman project, there's 50 lights there that we didn't have something in place at the time, so it went the path of that it normally goes, and I'm sorry. Yeah, that went. Sorry, you were going to ask a question.
No, I'm good.
So that is another item that we would need to consider for projects that are coming up, coming down the pipe that will be constructed and providing streetlights. What are we going to do with those? Who's going to be the responsible party?
And even if we did decide to go that route, we could still contract with JCSD for the maintenance.
Not the maintenance, yeah, but right. The management.
Or management.
You could still go the same path that we're right. doing right now should JCSD decide to buy all the street lights and we, cooperate with them on that avenue. Or you could start establishing the city's ownership of all streetlights moving from this point forward for all new developments. Mm-hmm. Now we have 12, but there's a lot more to come. Yeah. We're not done.
So it's almost one poll per staff member.
And the O&M is just, obviously it's optional for us. We have multiple choices down the road within option C of how we take care of the operation maintenance. Todd, how does JCSD deal with that right now? Is that just fully, Edison handles all the O&M? Yes. Got it.
Any issues related to the light pole, whether it's hit or bulb is out.
Yeah. So whether we use WR COGS or another third party, that's obviously under the option C, that is our jurisdiction to decide.
Correct.
But again, the also option is whether we want to manage it or allow JCSD to manage that or act as escrow. And kind of, that's the way I'm kind of picturing it, is they act as escrow. That's the way I can put it in my head. I don't know if that's accurate or not. That's the way it's kind of muddled up my mind.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I'm willing to entertain a motion.
So moved that we move forward with option C.
Second.
Yes.
Councilmember Rigby?
Aye.
Councilmember Rush?
Aye.
Mayor Pro Tem Obama?
Aye.
Mayor Desai?
Aye.
Motion passes 5-0.
With that, we will move on to item 10, city manager and staff reports.
No comments at this time.
All right. Excellent. All right. Council comments. Councilman Rush.
Thank you. The Nexus study for TUMF should be out in 2 weeks, pursuant to Mr. Gray at WR Cog. Several meetings will take place after that through admin and finance committees and then executive committee. In regards to TUMF, there was a recommendation at the end of January from Supervisor Jeffries, who covers the first district area, which is Temescal Canyon, kind of South Corona into Paris area, to form a committee of WRCOG executive members and RCTC members, and I think Mr. Lorimer mentioned to me earlier, as well as city managers, to explore the possibility of rolling in, whatever that means, TUMF under RCTC versus WRCOG. One of the main functions of WRCOG is obviously TUMF, and CVAG out in the desert was formed because of TUMF. So I've been volunteered on that committee. It's just getting started, so that's all we have on that point. There's an email today from Ms. Ann Mayer, executive director from RCTC, in regards to the I-15 project that is moving forward. During our subcommittee meeting on Limonite, I had asked Joe if there was any conflict between the I-15 express lane HOV project and this, and there shouldn't be. That is anticipated to go to construction as soon as 91 ends. 91 was supposed to open in December, but due to some rain delays and things of that nature, which is still actually way before schedule, it should be opening here in March or so. So there's going to be ribbon cutting and all that stuff. But if you haven't driven it lately, the 91 Express Lane is almost done. There will be some lingering construction issues and things of that nature, but it's looking good and whatnot. So I think that's it on that. In regards to the Cub Scout roadway issue, Tom had called me earlier today and we spoke at length. You know, and I understand his concerns. I also understand the liability issues. I think what I'd like to see is, if it's not in the existing language, you know, to provide our city manager with city attorney's advice and counsel some, you know, type of leeway or authority to approve some circumstances. You know, and I think if they provide a program, maybe it's just a letter spelling out, you know, what they're going to do. Because we're going to have these situations come up. I know when Vantage Point Church and New Day Church and the Crossings had done some community cleanups, and I've gone to a couple of those. The kids tag along. I'm not sure where the 10-year-old, you know, time frame or not time frame age came from, but you know, just give staff some leeway. And this is a guideline document, so you know, it's not set in ordinance. But I've seen them around the parks. I think they do a good job. You know, liability would be on them. So that was what I would like to see, if possible. And I also wanted to give kudos to whoever was the driver of a fire engine, right? Not a fire truck. Okay, the fire engine on Sunday, Super Bowl Sunday, and that unfortunate incident at the Vaughn Shopping Center. I was actually leaving Target. Why I went to Target 2 hours before Super Bowl was my fault. But anyways, and it was a rush. I mean, obviously, it was a critical situation, not knowing at the time there was three Eastvale police cars moving eastbound and the fire engine. And whoever is the driver of the fire engine, kudos to him. There was a very either surprised, shocked, or difficult driver that did not get out of the way. And he had to physically back up and move around him. So it was some good maneuvering in a very tense situation, and I was right there to kind of witness it. So that's all I have, Mr. Mayor. Thank you.
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, sir.
Councilmember Rush made a suggestion that staff come back with maybe some language on the policy for the Adopt the Roadway program to maybe accommodate the Cub Scouts. If we can get a consensus from the council that you would like that, that would be good for the record.
I was going to recommend the same thing myself. So do we, Councilman Rigby, how do you feel?
We just need a consensus from you that for us to do that.
Yeah, I agree.
I'm all for it. Sounds like
great.
We got it. Thank you.
Oh, I'm sorry, Mayor Tesari, if I could ask for one more item of consensus. Councilmember Rush had mentioned the TUMF program and that the proposed new fee would be coming out later this month. WRCOG has offered to have staff come and give a presentation at the request of the cities. So if there is a desire from our council to have a presentation explaining the TUMF program and the fee, I would be happy to arrange that.
This is like with the crazy ridiculous fee increases?
I think I'm fine with that suggestion. My concern, because I sat through my second meeting on WRCOG, but it's a lot of minutia. It's a lot of detail. I think if we do that, it'd probably have to be either earlier or, I mean, I hate to pull everybody out for a special meeting, but you can do it in 15 minutes and say, okay, yeah, that sounds great, but you really need like 45 minutes to an hour if we really wanted to digest it. It's not sexy, it's not fun, it's a lot of data, and what I got out of it Monday was, you know, kind of a parity issue, specifically on the retail fee, and I didn't know, and I haven't checked the veracity of this number, that I think 9% of the total revenue of TUMF comes from retail, and that the Riverside County retail TUMF fee is not on par, substantially lower than like our neighbors in San Bernardino County. Now, that being said, I've done a lot of private development work in San Bernardino County, and they don't have a regional fee. It's sub-regional. It's pockets on the county. There's a high desert one, there's a city one, there's one out for out by the Colorado River, and there's just kind of areas of focus, kind of like overlays where they see potential traffic. It's not countywide, and so I think on that aspect it is on par, but it's a little bit of apples to oranges. So leave it up to staff and how you want to structure it. Just be forewarned, it's a lot of information.
We could also just invite them to City Hall to give one-on-one, if that works better.
Yep.
Okay, thank you.
I think so. I mean, you know, maybe two at a, you know, they can come on 2 days and or 3 days. We could do two. I mean, I've been through it, and I'm gonna go through it. So I would exempt myself from that.
Maybe
they can do 2 days, and you know, gladly exempt myself from that. You know, and we can do one or two council members. I know, you know, Councilmember Littlemore might need to excuse himself, but one or two on a days, and just do it at a staff level. I think that'd be much more fruitful. We don't have people sitting here waiting, you know, talking about escalators and rolling in, phasing in commercial fees and per square foot, and
You don't need any kind of consensus for that, right? No.
Yeah. I mean, if you like that kind of stuff, hey, but.
Councilman Rigby.
Thank you. Just had a couple of things. Tomorrow, as I mentioned earlier, we have the Eastville Schools Committee meeting. I'm excited for that. One of the big issues that's been brought up, that was brought up by a resident recently, was the traffic situation around the school. So hopefully we'll get some work done on that. Just had a couple of questions on just a couple of updates. Do we have any update on the fire station right now, on where that's at on?
I was just down there before the meeting tonight. We're getting closer. Looks like construction. They moved all of their stuff out. They're in the process of cleaning it. The architect still has to do their architectural punch list walkthrough to make sure that everything architectural that's supposed to be done is done to their standard. And then we have to go through, do our walkthrough, make sure everything is to what we wanted as far as the paint and the walls and everything is where it's supposed to be. But we're definitely getting closer. I don't have an exact date when it's going to get turned over.
Not to hold you to anything, but are we looking at weeks or still months or?
I would say probably within a couple of weeks.
Okay, great.
Do you mind if I ask it? Just a, Joe, what's the road looking like over there? Is the road in shape?
Yeah, the roadway has been completed, south median portion of Chandler, and we still have to tweak a little bit on the signal, the red flashing light.
So the residents can egress and ingress out of there?
Oh, yes, sir.
Okay.
That's why I did. By the way, if you want to see the LED lights, sound and music LED lights.
Nice.
We use that as the city of light plan, so you want that those lights.
So we don't have to go to Hemet.
That's part of our
12. That's part of our 12.
Yeah. And save us the drive to Hemet.
Thank you.
One other question just on update. Lieutenant Forbes, you're doing a great job. But do we have any update on Captain Horton's replacement?
That's Chief Horton.
Chief Horton, I'm sorry.
We hope to have introduced the new captain at the next council meeting. I preface that by saying we hope. So, I'm maybe over optimistic, but I'm hoping to have a name by the end of the week. This week.
Great, thank you. And the last comment that I just had was one just for the public's information, but there was a resident that was very grateful for a particular deputy, Deputy Nuno, who responded to a non-responsive child. I'm not sure of the exact age, but just coming from a parent myself, as well as that parent, very appreciative for his response. And I don't think it's just him. I think it's the deputies in the area, and it starts with the leadership, so we appreciate that. And that's all.
Councilman Plott.
Yeah, Eastvale Parks Commission, they'll be meeting next week on February 16th, and then on the 23rd, have the RTA meeting, which Councilman Rigg is going to go for me. Actually, that same day, I have my ACL reconstruction surgery, so I'm not looking forward to that on that same day. But plan on being back at that, I'll be back in full effect by the next meeting, at least in crutches, but I'll be back. I did have one question in regards to, from January 11th, it was January 11th city council meeting, and I asked if it was in regards to into the maternity homes, and the birth tourism, that if the HOA or if someone, either a board member from the HOA or the community manager, have gotten back to you as regards to what the HOA plans on doing to help kind of assist their own community in this problem, which I've heard nothing back from them or know what is taking place, but I'd like to know what actions are being done by the HOA board there within the community that's actually having most of these issues.
Councilmember Plott, I had engaged the HOA. And I heard back today, as a matter of fact, that they can give me an update tomorrow. Okay. So at this point, I don't have any news from them, but I can certainly share that next time around.
Okay. Thank you.
Mayor Pro Tem Larimore.
Yes, sir. Thank you. I know that a number of us were there, but I really had a great time at the eSTEM Academy groundbreaking, and really looking forward to that coming to fruition here in town. $55 million facility being built. It's very cool. Excited for the next generations coming down the line. RCA, Riverside County Conservation Authority, Western Riverside, I should say. We had a meeting on Monday, and it was there wasn't a whole lot done. We did some things in closed session, but I can't share that. So, and we also had a meeting with SCAG, Southern California Association of Governments, had the monthly meeting on Thursday. I'm going to be sending out an update from the activities that took place there. Most of it was informational, and but that's why I'll be sending it along instead of going on and on. Also with coming up, League of California Cities, we're having our division meeting. It's going to be in Wildomar, and that's going to be next Monday. So if you guys haven't already done so, come on down and put in RSVP. And SCAG also bylaws committee, I was just added to that. We're going to be having our first meeting on that next Thursday. And also looking at the calendar down the line, right before our next council meeting, Tuesday the 21st, Eastvale Quarterly Town Hall. So come on down. Thank you.
I have a vector control meeting tomorrow, so I don't have an update. I'll have that for the next meeting. I just wanted to touch on Mr. Hernandez's suggestion about a reward. Can we look into that and see? I'll put up the first $100 for a reward for the arrest of people engaged in mail theft. I don't care about the conviction, because that's way down the road. I just want people in handcuffs.
Disposal.
And also, could we explore any type of, where can we get money to help pay for overtime, for crime suppression? Can we check with the Board of Supervisors? Maybe Tavoloni, out of, you know, his slush fund, he can throw some money this way. You know, the state, grant funding, I don't know, anything.
We are currently looking at grants through our grant writing consulting firm. The county has a major looming budget problem, so
yeah.
they do not have a slush fund.
Every supervisor has their own personal slush fund.
But we can certainly look into some type of an award program, and bring that back at a later date.
Thank you.
From our little tiny budget.
So $25 million systematic shortfall?
I'm sorry?
How much is it now? $25 million? $30
million? From the county?
Yeah.
Well, I believe it's actually bigger than that, because the state is pushing back down to the county the liability for hospice care.
Mm-hmm.
I believe that was $144 million getting pushed down from the state to the county to assume that liability.
Yeah.
So
it's insanity.
I had heard something like an $80 million problem. But that is not confirmed. That's through the grapevine.
There's an interesting read in the Press Enterprise on this. Check it out. JOR says they're going to keep the course. So.
They're going to what?
Keep the course.
Keep the course.
Wonderful. Meeting adjourned. Thank you.
Just can you send me that information?